imagine that you live on Earth 4,000 to 5,000 years ago. You are not literate. You are certainly not autonomous. You live a very simple life. When the sun rises, you get up, you go to work. Sun sets, you go home. Now imagine one day you're out in the field or you're out doing whatever you do, and it starts to get a little darker. You don't think anything of it, just a cloud going across the sun. But it keeps getting darker. And then the birds stop singing. And the other animals are settling down. The crickets start to chirp. You look up in the sky and the stars are starting to appear. You look up where you think the sun should be and you see this. Now, how would that make you feel? That's not terrible. Very scary, right? Well, we know that that's just a solar eclipse. In 3 weeks, we're going to experience a solar eclipse. So I wanted to share with you a little bit of history about the eclipse, some facts, and also a safe way to view. Now, ancient peoples have some great stories to try to explain what an eclipse is. This particular one is a painting from Korea. This is a black dog eating the sun. The word eclipse is from the Greek, meaning abandoned. So that gives you a taste of what the Greeks thought about the eclipses. It turns out there's been some discoveries that Babylonians and ancient Chinese were able to predict eclipses as long ago as 4,500 years. Now that doesn't mean that they weren't superstitious about it. They thought it was a bad omen for the rulers. So what would happen is when an eclipse was predicted, they would put a temporary ruler in place until the eclipse was over and then take their seat again. Now, if the astronomer was wrong, he was put to death. So they were highly motivated to get it right. Fast forward about a few thousand years, 1605. Johannes Kepler, the German mathematician and astronomer, came up with the first scientific description of what happens in an eclipse. And here we go. It's a little cut off there, but this isn't the scale. Basically, the moon is between us and the sun. We're in the moon's shadow. The sun is actually 400 times the size of the moon. But coincidentally, it is also about 400 times further away from the Earth than the moon is. So their apparent size is about the same. So that's why when the moon moves across the sun, we can see the corona. And the corona of the sun is the outer atmosphere of the sun. It's the only time you can see the corona, besides using a special telescope, is when during a total eclipse. This is a little bit closer, also still not to scale. So the part where you see totality, see the total eclipse, is called the umbra. That's the part of that. Darkest part of the shadow. Around the umbra is the penumbra, and that's where, if you're in that shadow, that's where you see partial eclipses. Where the umbra hits the Earth, that's called the path of totality. Now, 3 weeks from now, the path of totality is going to just go right across the United States. And it'll be the first time in 38 years that a total eclipse is visible from the continental United States. And there's the path. It's about 60 to 70 miles wide, and it goes right through Oregon. It's a little bit cut off, but we're right up there. You can see Puget Sound. We're very close. probably what you've heard mostly about this is that epic traffic jam that's going to happen on that day, like people trying to get to the path of totality, and the fact that there's a shortage of porta potties. But if you're not lucky enough to get into the path of totality and see a total eclipse, we're going to have a pretty good show here. We are going to be, the eclipse will be about 93% of totality. So there'll be a thin little crescent of the sun that we'll be able to see. Now, even though it's only 7% of the sun is so strong, stars aren't going to pop out for us, and the birds won't stop singing, but it's still going to be pretty dramatic. You probably will be able to see a couple of the brighter planets during that time. So, you want to see it. This is when it's going to happen. Monday, August the 21st. It lasts for about 2.5 hours, and you definitely want to see it. Now, hopefully there won't be a marine layer, but you definitely want to get in there around 10:20 to see the maximum, to see that moon slide over the sun. It'll be very exciting. Now, you do want to see it, right? With all this.
Yeah.
Your mother probably told you that if you look at the sun, you'll go blind. And she's right. You cannot look at the sun. It's very, very dangerous. You need special protection. Welding masks will work, but so will these little glasses. They must be ISO certified, which is the numbers over there, but they must be ISO certified. ISO means International Organization Standards, for those who aren't familiar. And with these, and even so, you need to read the instructions carefully, because even with these, you can't really gaze at the sun for very long periods of time all at once. Now, I've brought a whole bunch of them, and I'm going to put them over by the door, and I want you to take some home. I even have some kid sizes, or if you have kids, please take some. And they work really well. I looked at the sun the other day. It's pretty fun. Now, here's some resources. You don't have to copy these down if you're interested. I'll send these out in an email. But these are all the resources that I used for this talk today. But the amount of information that's out on the internet about the eclipse is just tremendous. There's such fun stuff. There's interactive maps. And I think NASA is actually going to live stream the eclipse. And of course, and if you're a photographer, you want to get some tips on how to photograph it, you can find it out there as well. And also, different ways to watch the eclipse without looking at it directly. And I don't have them listed here, but of course there are smartphone apps. Even with all of this information, I mean,